Herb. Herb is a plant. I mean, herbs are good for everything. Herb.
Welcome, Eugene Cannabis TV. You made the trip. We haven't made a few shows for, I haven't made a show for a couple of weeks, but we're back on doing it again and got some great stories for you and some information about cannabis. The main thing is get a notepad, a scrap of paper and a pen because you might hear something, I hope you hear something that you want to write down. First of all, we got our shout outs for parties and gatherings. This one, this is a hindsight. If you missed it, I was going to tell you about it. The Halloween party that I talked about, it was October 31st at the Happy Hours on River Road. That was a great event. We had some good music, and that was an excellent time. The next thing coming up is November 30th. Now put this on your calendar. This is in Kizer at the PCM Lodge in Kizer, the Cannabis Smoking Lodge, and that's a place to visit, I'm telling you. And we're having an event up there, and Normal Bean is doing the music. We've got some special guests. The event is called Canna Unite, and the point is we're trying to get people to come together on the cannabis issues, because even though it's legalized, we still got a lot of problems and still a lot of work to be done. So let's get together and unite. There's some good people out there, and it's a good place to meet some good people. December 3rd, again at the PGN Lodge in Kizer, Johnny Wheels and the Lugnuts, one of my absolute favorite groups, is going to be there. And that's going to be for the birthday party for the owner of the PGN Lodge. And so that's going to be a great party, and what a band, I'm telling you. You've been talking about it for a long time. I know I have been. Incredible. And then the biggest of all is the New Year's party, December 31st. It's going to be at the Jasper Grange in Jasper, just outside of Springfield. That's the second year at that venue, and last year's event was really, really great. It's a big venue. We're going to have some great music, potluck, and that's the Eugene Cannabis Club. Event. So anyway, I wanted to tell you about that, and be sure, like I say, put it in your calendar. December 31st, it's a Jasper Grange, and you can look under Normal Bean on Facebook and look into that. So let me get into this story. This is out of Oregon. I hate to start on a dark note, but there are some problems in the cannabis world, and this is was in the bensource.com, titled Deschutes County Marijuana Blues Turn a Darker Hue, by Jeremy Dickman. The blue wave that swept dozens of Democrats into the U.S. House didn't mean much to those of us residing in what is still decidedly Trump country. Reefer madness now dominates the Deschutes County Commission in the forms of incumbent Phil Henderson and Commissioner-elect Patty Adair, who defeated Democrat James Cook by a thin margin despite receiving scant support from the usual Republican backers. Incumbent Tony DeBone is also keeping his seat, meaning not a single truly progressive voice on marijuana policy in the county will discourage the board from waging what amounts to an outright fear campaign against marijuana entrepreneurs. Not only will the tightening of regulatory burdens on the cannabis industry affect cannabis entrepreneurs, but it may open up the county to lawsuits. The county's land use board of appeals defines reasonable regulations which may exclude what Deschutes County has proposed in its emergency rulemaking last month. Among other rules, growers, processors, and retailers are now prohibited from the multi-use agricultural MUI-10 zones. Property line setbacks have been increased by 50%, and the off-site dwelling setbacks were bumped up by one-third. Stephanie Marshall, a Bend-based land use attorney, wrote October 26th on the Clifton Cannabis Law blog, quote, "The code revisions are punitive and unduly onerous, which will result in the very effect the county is hoping to avoid, a proliferation of unlicensed operations. Licensees have been shown to be responsibly operating within the confines of state and local law. The mere disapproval by some constituents of marijuana in general, without more, is not a reasonable basis to increase the burdens and costs of compliance and minimize the available lands for production. The commission's shakeup means applicants who appear before the board to obtain permit approval for everything from new marijuana farms to enhancements of existing processing facilities will likely face unreasonable interpretations of the already unreasonable rules. Odor control devices, for example, don't ever seem to please the board. Even when medicinal or mechanical engineers testify that the skunk tank can't reach the skunk stank can't reach the neighbors, an applicant will still count on at least one no vote from Henderson, who seems to fancy himself an odor control scientist. You can expect more pseudoscience from Adair, who claimed in a debate that the 1980 Mount St. Helens eruption resulted in years of nicer weather in Seattle, never minding the ash, presumably, the melting of the Greenland ice shelf. That shouldn't be a big deal in 2006. Anyway, Adair testified before the board at that time, considering whether to opt back into adult use marijuana, that she likes the smell of alfalfa, not pot. If only she were simple entertainment. Anyway, meanwhile, in Sisters, voters overwhelmingly approved an additional tax on recreational marijuana sold in the city. The only problem? They voted down a measure that would have allowed any sale of cannabis within city limits. Can anyone remember another time when Republicans were so anti-business and pro-tax in one election? Democratic gains for ganja. Still, more Democrats in Congress bodes well for the future of a nationwide end to prohibition. But there were some specific victories that were particularly encouraging. Michigan became the 10th state to legalize adult use of marijuana, and Missouri and Utah legalized medical cannabis. 25% of Americans now live in a state where recreational marijuana is legal, and 33 states have legalized medical marijuana. Meanwhile, Representative Pete Sessions, a Republican of Texas, a rabid prohibitionist and chairman of the House Rules Committee, who blocked House members from voting on bipartisan marijuana reform, lost his seat to a former Texas Titans linebacker. Thanks to Sessions, bipartisan bills such as banking reform for cannabis companies and felicitation of medical cannabis for veterans never saw a vote. Sessions out. Pete wasn't the only Sessions to lose a job. Jeff Sessions, virtually anti-pot, submitted his not-so-voluntary resignation as Attorney General and will be temporarily replaced by Matt Whitaker. But there's a lot here for anti-prohibitionists to applaud. The potential AG candidates publicly banded about include Pam Bondi, the current Florida Attorney General, and Chris Christie, the former New Jersey governor. Bondi is most likely to bend to the tidal wave of public opinion in favor of legal cannabis. Christie has referred to cannabis taxes as blood money. But Sessions certainly wasn't forced out over his marijuana views, so don't get too excited about his replacement. Way to go, Billy. Just before resigning, Sessions appointed Billy Williams, the U.S. Attorney for the District of Oregon. the chair of the Attorney General's Marijuana Working Group. Williams is far from an apologist for Oregon's marijuana laws and has criticized the state over black market trafficking. That impact, what impact will this have? Look for the OLCC, a frequent target of Williams' critiques, to hit violations harder, and don't hold your breath on a quick resumption of new licenses since they halted the proceeding of applications June 15th. So problems continue in the legal cannabis realm. So, problems. A quick note about this is from weednews.com, written by Timothy Edwards, dated November 14th. Sean Beeman of Genesis Farms. Sean's been on the show several times. The last one is a lot long ago, talking about suppositories and using RSO that way. It's a lot less psychoactive reaction, so you can take a higher dose and it's not as uncomfortable. It works very well. Anyway, Genesis Farms has taken first place in the Oregon Dope Cup Awards for best RSO with whole plate concentrate. The focus of our company is the therapeutic side of cannabis, said Genesis Farmers owner Sean Beeman. He worked very hard to provide the best therapeutic product possible in a recreational market. When they are involved in the medical market, they had an 80% saturation rate. Trying to promote a therapeutic product in a recreational market is harder and requires a lot of training and education. Beeman takes education very seriously. He goes into shops and trains everyone from the bud tender to the owner on the therapeutic uses that are out there. Genesis Farms has different variants that they grow in the garden with different ratios of THC and CBD. Some are high THC, some have high CBD. Beeman's effort to provide the best therapeutic product on the market comes from a personal place and involves his health issues that he treats with RSL. In 2005, Beeman was diagnosed with hepatitis C, which he believes he contracted through the air shots received in boot camp when he served in the military. He was also diagnosed with having grade 4 stage liver cirrhosis. He was in the late stage when diagnosed. At first, he tried everything that he could find on the internet to treat, and it didn't get much relief. In 2010, he took the first dose of RSO and knew from day one that it was going to help him to heal. If you took too much RSO too quickly, it could become uncomfortable, but I literally was fighting for my life, said Beeman. So that's, again, Sean Beeman, and congratulations for winning first place in the Oregon Dope Cup Awards for the best RSO. From the whole plant concentrate. So we appreciate that. And Sean's doing great work helping patients, and say he's been on the show multiple times, and he'll be back again. Always have an invitation. He's always said he'll be back anytime we ask him to, so we will definitely have him back and giving out that good information. Also, we're always looking for guests, so tell your cannabis story. Come on Eugene Cannabis TV and tell your story. It's a lot of fun, really is, and you'll have your friends can see you on TV. So we're going to take a quick break and be back for the second half. So stand by. Welcome back to the second half of Eugene Cannabis TV. The last first half, we talked about Sean Beeman, a friend of ours, and had the dark news of a problem in eastern Oregon with canna bigotry, as we like to say. But here's something that's comes from out of state, but it certainly is exciting. And I definitely wanted to talk about this. This was in the yourhealthinfo.com. and it was October 16th, 2018. Courts rule workers cannot be denied employment for medical cannabis use. After years of upholding employment firings for use of cannabis, even under state medical marijuana programs, the courts are finally starting to turn around on the question. One of the ways medical marijuana programs have failed to fully extend protection to medical users is in their failure to defend against employment discrimination. This is now beginning to change, thanks to a few recent court decisions in favor of patients and employees. The case of Connecticut healthcare worker Caitlin Nofsinger was profiled by the Associated Press on October 2nd. At her job interview with the Bridebrook Health and Rehabilitation Center in Nyantick, where she had applied for the position of recreation therapy director, Nofsinger openly stated that she used a medical marijuana product to control the PTSD she was suffering from since a car crash, and emphasized that she only took it before bed at night so she would not be under its influence on the job. Nonetheless, when a drug test came back positive for THC, the nursing home withdrew the job offer. Nofsinger went to court in 2016, and last month, District Court Judge Jeffrey Meyer in New Haven ruled that the nursing home had violated an anti-discrimination provision of Connecticut's medical marijuana law. The case isn't over, as the judge denied Nofsinger's request for punitive damages. The next move is a trial to determine whether she should receive compensatory damages for lost wages for not getting the job. Further details are provided by the Jackson Lewis Law Blog. Nofsinger was registered as a qualifying patient under Connecticut Palliative Use of Marijuana Act. She was, however, using Marinol, synthetic THC in capsule form. The Marinol is an FDA-approved prescription drug and is in Schedule 3, the DEA classification for drugs with legitimate medical applications and a low potential of abuse. This despite the fact that the DEA officially clarified in December 2016 that all cannabis extracts remain in the highly restrictive Schedule 1, the same classification as the cannabis plant itself. The ostensible justification for this contradiction is that Marinol contains a synthetic form of THC, not an actual plant-derived extract. In any case, Marinol's legal status makes the denial of the position to Nofsinger all the more outrageous. Similar victories in Massachusetts, Rhode Island. As the Associated Press account notes, the Connecticut decision was the first ruling of its kind in a federal case, but it followed similar recent rulings against employers by state courts in Massachusetts and Rhode Island. This begins to reverse an earlier trend which saw the high courts in California, Colorado, Oregon, and Washington rule in favor of employers in discrimination suits over medical marijuana use. This decision reflects the rapidly changing culture and legal status of cannabis and affirms that employers should not be able to discriminate against those who use marijuana responsibly while off the job, in compliance with laws of their state. Paul Armentano, deputy director of the National Organization for the Reform of Marijuana Laws, said to AP, by the count of the National Conference of State Legislatures, 31 states, plus the District of Columbia, Puerto Rico, and Guam, now have medical marijuana programs, while 15 others have more limited programs allowing use of low THC but high CBD preparations for medical use. Only 9 states, including Connecticut, have explicitly barred unemployment discrimination against medical marijuana users. In June 2017, the Massachusetts Supreme Court ruled that a sales and marketing company wrongly fired employee Christine Barbuto after she tested positive for marijuana. which she used under the state's medical program to treat her Crohn's disease. In May 2017, the Rhode Island Supreme Court found that a college student was wrongly denied an internship at a fabric company after she acknowledged she could not pass a drug test because of her medical marijuana use. The denial was deemed to violate the state's Disability Discrimination Act as well as provisions of the medical marijuana law. The American Bar Association called the Connecticut, Massachusetts, and Rhode Island cases an emerging trend in employment litigation and advised employers to take state medical marijuana laws into consideration when crafting their drug use and testing policies. All this must surely be viewed as vindictive by Brandon Coates, a Colorado quadriplegic who was fired by a TV company in 2010 after he failed a drug test in June 2015. The Colorado Supreme Court unanimously upheld a lower court decision that the company's zero-tolerance drug policies were not preempted by Colorado's medical marijuana law. So that's interesting, and like I mentioned in the article, Oregon's had some cases there and it went against the patients. So it's so wrong and so egregiously wrong. And I've got some, with just the latest OCC meeting in Portland, there were some people that testified and trying to save the medical marijuana program. These are some great testimonies, and I thought I'd bring some in. Very, very touching. Starts out, this is one. Thank you for your time today. My name is Ms. Blank. I would like to begin by stating that I recently was inspected by the OMMP and would like to tell you about that experience. First off, I printed off the OMMP website, my first list of patients for the day. We got inspected. OMMP patient website stated that I had 7 plants registered and one also had one other patient with the temporary paperwork that is legal by state statute, and it's cited here. There should have been no reason for them to tag any of my patients' plants. The inspector told me I was wrong. We as growers can only go by the state website, which is our avenue to see where we stand with patient cards. We put our faith in the OHA OMMP. Now those patients have no meds due to losing 28 plants to mold. The inspectors tagged 28 plants and now say they only tagged 18. I have pictures of the 28 tagged plants. That's at least 10 more that could have been saved for patients. Some of the other problems we have with the OHA OMMP is the fact that we have gotten double charged on more than one occasion for grower fees. We sent them in and then also got told to pay online. So why are we being charged $400 per patient to grow? What recourse do we have to get our funds back? I do have copies of all money orders we sent to the OHA OMMP. What you do not understand is that the patients have had enough, and we are now forming groups for civil suits against the state of Oregon and the OMMP, and by illegally detaining our plants, they are opening themselves up to more civil and small claim suits. The hardest thing for me to understand is why I and others have been allowed to grow at these sites for 3 to 6 years, and now all of a sudden our addresses are not legit. Do you not think we deserve some sort of notice that this was the problem before you accepted our grower fees so it could have gotten corrected or at least had a suitable compromise for everyone involved before all the patients' meds were lost to mold? We were also forced to buy scales. Well, we are not selling in any way and are not a commercial grow. Why do we need scales? Once again, Measure 91 was not supposed to touch the medical program, but here we are with an almost completely disabled medical system for those who need this medicine the most, not those who use it for a higher financial gain. So that's Well put, well said, and well heard, as I like to say. And the stories just go on and on. Thank you for your time today. My name is again Blank. I've been a patient in the OMMP for 17 years. I originally got my medical card due to extremely severe pain from multiple back surgeries and a cage placement in my back. I was a smoker in my youth, but did not begin to realize the medical benefits of the plant until I became an Oregon patient, a resident. This incredible medicine helped me so much with my pain, and later in my life, I was diagnosed with stage 4 cancer. And my opinion of this miracle plant changed once again. I truly feel that the end of this program is near, and that is a very scary thought for me. I was on Vicodin for over 20 years because of my back. Now that I can treat myself with cannabis, I no longer need Vicodin. I eat 2 CBD medibles each morning and a THC edible each night, and it replaced over 120 pills a month. I also got off my antidepressants. I cannot grow physically because it's too hard on me, and finding someone to grow for anyone has become an impossible task. My best grower can no longer afford to grow for me or anyone else. I have heard in Douglas County, Josephine County, they're requiring inspections yearly now for compliance. So they are making growers go through 3 compliance checks, no matter they don't want to help any. No wonder they don't want to help anymore. There would be no recreational without the medical program. It's about time we got it back and got back to that. So, well said again, and well heard. So we definitely need to save the medical program. I encourage you, please renew your card if you physically, financially can do it. Please do it. We'll be talking more about that in the future. Once again, don't forget New Year's party. That's a big one. New Year's December 31st. That's at the Grange. In Jasper, Oregon, that is the one not to be missed. I just tell you that one there. So, and always looking for guests. So come on down and see us at the behind the Sheldon High School at the Community TV 29 Studios Monday nights at 4:30. So hope to see you there. We'll be here, and I hope Decky will be too. So we'll see you there or here or somewhere. See ya.